So hello and welcome to our new season of Data for the People presented by Rock EDU Science Outreach. My name is Devin Collins and I'm the Program Manager for Outreach and Engagement Initiatives at Rock EDU. Data for the People is an interactive web series that invites all people to engage with scientific research topics presented by scientists from our communities. Information is sourced directly from primary scientific literature and explored in a way that maintains the rigor of the research while eliminating all of the inaccessible jargon. Because everyone has a right to access primary scientific information and explore how science connects to our society. The theme for this season of Data for the People is people and medicine. And during this season, we'll explore the science of how we study ourselves. We'll learn how our complexity as organisms and as people with unique lives, identities, characteristics, create challenges and opportunities for improving human health. We'll also draw through lines from the past to the present, examining how historical biases and power structures have influenced the way scientific knowledge is generated, valued, and transformed into medical advances. Drawing from more current research, we'll consider the question, how do we study ourselves? Through topics like the ethics of genome sequencing studies, the rationale for gender and race-balanced clinical trials, and the role of social inequities in healthcare access and outcomes. We'll also explore new innovative practices from designing experiments that more closely match our biology to uniting patients and scientists in the study of rare diseases to ask the next and even more important question, how do we get better at studying ourselves? So we are going to explore that question today in a few different places where our personal identities and social biases interact with science. Humans are social animals, so scientists who study humans have to consider both biological and social factors in their research. And factors such as gender, race, ethnicity, class, culture, economy, and more influence studies of human biology. And we have two really amazing speakers today to help us explore those questions. So today's speakers are Angela Lee and Dr. Luz Jubiere. And I will give a quick introduction of both of them. So Angela is a PhD candidate in the immunology and microbial pathogenesis program at Weill Cornell Medical College. Here she studies the role of a type of molecule that works in our immune system called interferon on cell death in macrophages, which are a very important cell type in the immune system. Specifically, she studies those cells in the context of Mycobacterium tuberculosis infection, and she works in the laboratory of Dr. Carl Nathan. Before starting the PhD program at Weill Cornell, Angela obtained a master's in integrated immunology at the University of Oxford, and she worked at the National Institutes of Health as a postbac. In both institutions, she studied other immune cells like as well, and their response to varying antigen affinities in hopes of optimizing cancer immunotherapies. In her free time, Angela likes to cook, dance, and paint. Originally from Spain, Luz is now a postdoctoral researcher at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in the laboratory of Dr. Kensis. There, she studies the genetics of neuronal diversity during brain development and how those processes sometimes go wrong and produce cancer in children. Before moving to Memorial Sloan Kettering, she obtained her PhD in Barcelona under the supervision of Dr. Miguel Segura. In her thesis, she focused on the development of epigenetic therapies for high-risk neuroblastomas, which are a type of cancer that is found very often in childhood. Along with her passion for science, Luz also has a deep love for music, being a pianist and a singer. She loves to spend her free time at Carnegie Hall, the Met Opera, and the many jazz clubs that you can find around the city. As Angela and Luz present, please be sure to plug in your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen, and we'll take some time after the presentation to get through as many of your questions as possible. Okay, we are almost ready to get started. But before we get started with today's discussion, we just want to go over a couple of acknowledgments and norms. First and foremost, I want to acknowledge that the land that the Rockefeller University was built on is part of the ancestral Lenape homelands. And we recognize that the longstanding significance of these lands for Lenape nations, past and present. We're also conscious that New York City has the largest urban Native population in the United States. And we believe that historical awareness of Indigenous exclusion and erasure is critically important. And we are committed to working to overcome their effects in our own educational institutions. A disclaimer, we are coming from a background of scientific research and we're not medical doctors. We will not be giving medical advice in this webinar. This is explicitly for the purposes of education and discussions. We do not want to go outside of the bounds of our knowledge, so we ask that you ask questions that are related to the papers being presented today. And to help keep this organized while also allowing audience members to ask questions, we'll open up the Q&A section for answering questions after the speakers are finished presenting the research. We'll try to take as many questions as we can, and thank you for being with us on this. These sessions are recorded and the archives will be shared at rockedu.rockefeller.edu, also known as rockedu online. So that's enough of me speaking. Angela, Luth, thanks for being with us today, and I will turn it over to you.
So I feel now like Damon already gave such a good introduction that now I'm just going to repeat myself. But my name is Luth, which means light in Spanish. And I'm originally from a really small village called Alcañiz. And as you can see, all my nouns are so difficult to pronounce. But then to do my my studies, I moved to Barcelona. And sorry, I don't know. Angela, can you click the next thing? No, no worries. Yeah, I moved to Barcelona to do my undergrad and my graduate studies, where I got my PhD and my master's. And then I moved to New York to do my postdoc in neuronal development. But not only that, I've been enjoying a lot of what New York and the US has to offer. I love snowboarding, as you can see here in this picture of me, like this past Christmas. And I also have a dog that is a silly goose. And I love, as Devon say, I love music, and I especially classical and jazz. And I sing in some jam sessions around the city. So you can sometimes see me there, like, shaming myself a little bit. And then next, I'll pass the mic to Angela.
Hi, everyone. I'm Angela. Devon already gave a great introduction, so I will also be repeating myself. But I'm actually from here in New York. And I became interested in science in high school when I was part of a science research program. And I also interned at the American Museum of Natural History during the summers, in which we got to do some cool stuff like touch dinosaur fossils behind the scenes. And I became particularly interested in microbiology and immunology when I attended college on the Upper West Side. I went to Barnard College. My favorite class was lab class was in microbiology lab. We were able to make beer and yogurt. And even though we were underage, we even got to drink the beer because it was technically educational. And then after college, I did a master's at the University of Oxford in integrated immunology. I went to the NIH, the National Institutes of Health, to do a post-bac program. And then I came back to New York to do a PhD program in immunology and microbial pathogenesis. And I'm currently a fifth year PhD student. So in this session of this season of D4P, we're exploring how do we study ourselves. And the first thing that we need to consider when doing human research is the ethics and rules and regulations that we must follow when using humans as test subjects. The Belmont Report, published in 1979, and commissioned and written by the National Commission for the Protection of Human Subjects of Biomedical and Behavioral Research, outlines the ethical principles and guidelines that we should follow. So the three basic principles are respect for persons, benefits, and justice. And I just realized they're all one for some reason now. So respect for persons is respecting people's autonomy to decide whether or not to participate in a study. And we can apply this principle in practice by having informed consent. So we inform the potential subjects about what the study is about, what the possible risks and benefits of participating in the study, and what compensations they might receive. And then they have to voluntarily agree to participate in the research without coercion, without being coerced into doing it. The second principle, benefits, goes beyond just what we might think of benefits, which is to do good. It also means to we're obliged to not harm and to assess the risks and benefits, to maximize the benefits and minimize the risks. So we can apply this principle by doing a risk-benefit assessment and making sure that we really try to maximize on the benefits and decrease the harm that the study can do. And the third principle is justice, and that is to ensure equal distribution of the burden of participating in the study and of the benefits that the study might produce. For example, a drug or a therapy that might come out of a research. And we can apply this principle in practice when we select the subjects for the study. So in this particular session of D4P, we're looking into which social factors we should consider when studying humans. Specifically, which populations should we study and which drugs or substances should we study? So in terms of which populations should we study, we are composed of different races, genders, socioeconomic classes, ages, etc. And the Belmont report, when they talk about justice, indicates that certain populations are more disadvantaged and vulnerable in our society than others. So even if the scientists treat the different subjects fairly, we have to further protect more vulnerable populations. For example, by choosing certain populations over others to study. For example, we might want to choose adults over children because adults are more vulnerable. But that can conflict with benefits because we can only really understand and gain knowledge that would benefit a particular population if we study them. So it's a delicate balance between the two. And in today's session, I will talk more just about race, because you can take a whole course to discuss all of these different topics. And then Luth will discuss which drugs are allowed to be researched. Certain drugs have been made illegal because of the opioid crisis and because they pose a health risk to individuals and to society at large. But modifications of these drugs may be potentially therapeutic. And so Luth will explore how we might need to reevaluate whether we study these illegal drugs or not, and what are the risks and benefits of studying these drugs. And we will discuss these topics in two scientific papers. So before we get into the papers, let's just take a step back and discuss scientific literature. So scientific literature can be broken up into three parts. You have primary, secondary, and tertiary literature. Primary literature is when a scientist has an original idea or original hypothesis. He or she does the experiment and tests the hypothesis and then writes a paper about it. Secondary literature is when another scientist reviews, summarizes, or interprets what has been written in the primary literature. And tertiary literature is something you may be more familiar with, is literature that is written, taken from information from the secondary and primary literature and written to to reach out to the public, to non-specialists. So these include examples like newspapers and magazines or websites. Both of the papers that Luth and I will discuss today are from the journal Science, and they are both part of the primary literature. So this is what the first page of the article that I will discuss looks like. And if we break it down, on the top, we have the what type of article it is. So this is a research article, meaning that this is a study in which the scientists did experiments and showed their data and talked about their data. It is in the field of immunogenomics, which is studying the genes of the immune system. The title is Genetic Ancestry Effects on the Response to Viral Infection or Pervasive but Cell Type Specific. And the authors are Haley E. Randolph. So she's the first author, which means she led the project. She did most of the experiments. She probably wrote up the paper. And then you have many middle authors. So they might have contributed by giving some ideas, helping with the analysis of the results, or even doing some experiments. And then the last author is the Louis B. Barrero, who is generally the head of the lab, the principal investigator of the lab. And we can find more information about these authors on the bottom. So we can see that they come from the departments of genetics, genomics, and system biology, and the departments of microbiology and immunology. So scientists will often collaborate with one another if one lab has a specialty in one area and another lab has a specialty in another area. Like here, one is has a specialty in immunology and one has a specialty in genetics. And the scientists are not restricted to their university or institution to collaborate. So we can see that in this case, the authors come from two different universities, the University of Chicago and the University of Minnesota. And then at the very bottom, we can have a citation of the article. So we have the first author's last name, Randolph et al., meaning and all, in the Journal of Science, their volume number being 374, their pages, page numbers, and then the date it was published. And lastly, we have the abstract, which is a summary of the article. So the title of this article is Genetic Ancestry Effects on the Response to Viral Infection are Pervasive but Cell Type Specific. What does this mean? I would translate it to be something like people of different races respond to viral infections differently, and those differences depend on the type of cell. So the main questions that the authors were trying to figure out are, do people of different races respond differently to viruses because our ancestors were exposed to different viruses? And how does the immune response of those different races differ? So they hypothesized that if you have a population of people in the past, like maybe hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands of years ago, and one population stayed in Africa while another population moved to Europe, they were geographically stratified or geographically separated. And the people who were in Africa were exposed to certain types of viruses, and only the people who were immune to those viruses would survive and have children and reproduce, while the people in Europe were exposed to other viruses, and only the people immune to those viruses would survive, have children, and reproduce. It's important to note here that the authors write about their test subjects as people or men of African or European ancestry, and they don't specifically talk about race. And that's because race is not a biological category, but rather a social one. But we may infer race based on a person's genetic ancestry, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. So, how do we respond when we get infected by a virus? And how are those immune differences different between people of different races? So in this paper, they used the influenza A virus as a model, and they infected immune cells derived from the blood. And cells can recognize when they're being infected by different sensors. For example, they can recognize RNA through RNA sensors. And when this occurs, the cell signals for alarms to be set off, like a fire alarm. And one type of alarm is called interferons, thus named because they interfere with viral replication. Like a fire alarm, it's not always turned on. It has to be turned on. And so interferons are turned on when they are transcribed into working copies called mRNA. And the mRNA then is translated into proteins, and they're now called interferon proteins. So these interferon proteins can be secreted and released and recognized by other cells by interferon receptors, just like we hear fire alarms through our ears. Upon recognizing the interferons, this recipient cell then signals for more genes to be turned on, these genes being called interferon-stimulated genes, which then also transcribe working copies or IHG mRNA and translate them into proteins. And these IHGs function in inhibiting viral replication by cleaving RNA, viral RNA. They can signal infected cells to commit suicide so that the virus doesn't further spread. And they can activate immune cells or train and mobilize immune cells. So you may have heard of companies like 23andMe or Ancestry.com. And what they do is they sequence DNA in order to determine your ancestry and determine which genes or gene variations that you may have. And they can be very powerful for determining this, but there's a limitation in DNA sequencing, and that is it doesn't tell you if a gene is turned on or not. So this is where mRNA can be really useful. If we sequence mRNA through RNA sequencing, we can determine whether or not the gene is turned on or not. We can determine for how long the gene is turned on for, and we can determine at to what magnitude the gene is turned on. So is it turned on very highly or lowly or medium? And because there are hundreds of different ISGs, the researchers didn't report every single individual ISG. Rather, they compiled the ISGs. They calculated an estimate of the ISG scores, and they called this the interferon score. And this process of determining whether a gene is turned on or not is called gene expression. So they're looking at the gene expression of ISGs during influenza infection. So how the authors go about just determining how the different immune responses of the different races differ, one way they do this is by looking at whether the interferon scores are response is higher or lower in African or European men or men of African or European genetic ancestry. So what they did was they took men who self-identified as being of African or European descent. They took their blood. They isolated the immune cells from the blood and separated them out from red blood cells and plasma and other components of the blood. And then they infected those cells with the influenza A virus. And then they did DNA sequencing to determine their ancestry and RNA sequencing to determine their immune response and interferon response. So first they did the DNA sequencing. Even though they recruited men who self-identified as being African or of African or European ancestry, they wanted to really determine that for themselves and to also see what proportion of their genome was of African versus European ancestry. And so in figure 1A, they showed an illustration of this, but in the supplementary materials, they show the actual data. And so if we look at how they do this, on the x-axis, they showed the individual identifiers. So each line is a different person. And the reason why they use these identifiers rather than their names is because they want to protect the identity of the subjects, which is also really important when doing human research, is to protect the confidentiality of your test subjects. And then they looked at what proportion of their genome was of European or of African ancestry. And what you can see is that while there are people who are almost 100% of African ancestry or of European ancestry, there exists more of a continuum of African and European ancestry. And what's also interesting to see is that of the men who have mostly African ancestry, a lot of them have some European ancestry, while those of European ancestry, mostly European ancestry, don't seem to have much African ancestry. You may think about why that might be. These men were collected from people in the United States. And so maybe these results might differ if you're looking at men from who reside in Europe or who reside in Africa. But nonetheless, you can see that rather than the men being of a black and white, of either literally black and white, they exist more in a continuum. So now that the authors have identified this continuum of African ancestry, they then wanted to look at the immune response. And you can see that if there is no correlation with the interferon score, that there would be a horizontal line. If there's a positive correlation, where there's, if you have a greater African ancestry, you have a greater interferon score, you'd see this increasing line. And if there's a negative correlation, then you would see that as you increase in African ancestry, you decrease in the interferon score. So what did the authors actually see? So they saw that in the solid lines, which represent the infected, influenza infected cells, that there's a negative correlation across all of these different types of immune cells. So as you increase in African ancestry, these cells have a lower interferon score. And the mock treated, which means they were not infected with influenza, has a horizontal, no correlation, which makes sense. So the next thing they wanted to determine is whether this interferon score correlates with viral load. And so it's well known that interferons are really important for controlling viral infection, and they wanted to just prove that. So if you have a low interferon score, we're expecting to see a high viral load. And if you have a high interferon score, we're expecting a low viral load. So the authors measure the viral load by doing a plaque assay, in which they measure the plaque-forming units, which is really a way to measure the viral load. And as expected, if you have a low interferon score, there's higher amounts of viruses. And if there's high interferon score, you have a lower amounts of viruses. So interferons are important not just for influenza, as we can just see. They're also really important for other viruses. And more recently, it's been shown that it's really important in fighting COVID. And so you probably have heard that people who are more susceptible to death and severe COVID are older people, men, and minority groups, as well as people with underlying medical conditions. And what's really interesting to see is that, for example, men have more proportions of interferon autoantibodies. So you might have heard of antibodies against SARS-CoV-2, which means they block and inhibit SARS-CoV-2. So antibodies against interferons block interferon signaling and response. And so we can see that some of that reason why men are more susceptible to SARS-CoV-2 may be because they have more interferon antibodies. Likewise, older people are generally have a lower interferon response to viral infection and a delayed interferon response. So the next question this might raise is, what about for minority groups? Is interferons less in minority groups? And maybe is that a reason for why certain minority groups are more at risk for severe COVID? As we can see in this chart by the CDC, people of Native American, Black, or Hispanic backgrounds are almost twice as likely to get to die from COVID than compared to white people. And so perhaps interferons might be explaining this. So the conclusions of this paper is that European ancestry is associated with a stronger interferon response to influenza, and that a stronger interferon response is associated with reduced viral load, that these genetic differences between races may exacerbate already existing healthcare disparities. And this paper was really important for me in my thesis because I studied type 1 interferons in the context of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And even though we were recruiting people indiscriminately of their race and gender, we decided after reading this paper that we should also start recording people's race and gender in our experiments. And the main limitations of this paper is that they did not directly test if the immune cells from the men of African ancestry had a higher viral load. They did more of a correlation of showing that men of African ancestry had a lower interferon response, and that a lower interferon response correlated with having a higher viral load. And the other limitation, I think, about the study is that they only studied men of African and European ancestry. They said they did this because they wanted to increase the power of the study, meaning they wanted to increase the likelihood that they would find the results to be statistically significant. But what they could have done is just done both men and women, and then when they analyzed those different gender populations, just analyze them separately. And also, yes, they only looked at men of African and European ancestry, and it would have been good if they looked at other types of ancestry as well. And with that, I'd like to thank you and pass it on to Luth, who will discuss not just who we should study, but what we should study. And I'll stop sharing so Luth can share a screen.
Okay, so as Angela very well explained before, I'm also gonna present a research article in Science. In this case, the topic is structural biology. And this research has been done in molecular biology laboratories in Shanghai. And the two main authors are the first author, Dongmei Chao, and the last author, Jun Wang. The title of this paper is Structure-Based Discovery of Non-Hallucinogenic Psychedelic Analogs, which basically translates as, can we intentionally develop antidepressants derived from hallucinogenic drugs without the hallucinogenic part? So first, a little bit of background on this. What are psychedelic or hallucinogenic drugs? We can find them in nature, both in plants and fungi. And I put here two examples. For example, in plants, one of the examples would be ayahuasca. And it comes from this vine that contains DMT, one of the most potent hallucinogenic drug that we know. And in fungi, we have what in the streets they call the magic mushrooms, or like more correctly, psilocybin-containing mushrooms. And these mushrooms contain psilocybin, which is the component that induces the hallucinations. So originally in many human cultures, they have used these type of plants and fungi in rites, in shamanic rites. But in more recent history, in 1938, Dr. Hoffman synthesized LSD, one of the first psychedelic drugs that were synthesized in a lab. And almost a decade later, in 1947, the Sandoz Labs started commercializing LSD as deli seed, and they marketized it as a drug that could be used to model schizophrenia, because these drugs, in a sense, induced in non-diseased brains, induce what happens in some in schizophrenic brains. So in 1952, Dr. Charles Savage and Dr. Osmond started using LSD as a treatment for depression and alcoholism. And then a decade later, in 1966, psychedelics were prohibited. And in 1970, they fell under the United States Controlled Substance Act, which basically means that this act, whatever drug fell under this act, meant that these drugs cannot be used for treatment for humans, because they have no interest in human health. The only thing that that is doing to humans is creating addiction. Later on in 1990, it happened what we call the psychedelic renaissance, because a few things that fell under the act got eliminated, so we could start researching these drugs again. And on 1998, we discovered, 8 years after the psychedelic renaissance, we discovered the mechanism of action of LSD and psilocybin that binds to this receptor called 5-HT2A. There, a couple of years ago, in 2021, we found that psilocybin is as effective as other current antidepressants for treating depression. So why psychedelics can be used as depression treatment? Before I get into the specifics, I want to give a few definitions so everybody's on the same page. I want to define what is a neuron. That basically is the fundamental unit or cell of our nervous system. And they are able to receive sensory inputs from the outer world, and they transform it into chemical signals, or also called neurotransmitter, that process information and pass it to other cells. This neurotransmitter, or the chemical messengers of the brain, can be found in three flavors. They are excitatory, which means basically that when a neuron passes this message to the next one, is activating it. They are inhibitory, when a neuron inhibits the next neuron. Or they are modulatory, that basically they are tweaking or adjusting the communication between these two neurons. And under the modulatory neurotransmitters, we can find serotonin, or 5-hydrotryptamine, 5-HT, which is a modulatory neurotransmitter, which tweaks, as I said, tweaks or adjusts the communication between neurons. So here I'm showing a diagram of an interaction of two neurons. And on the upper part, you can see what we call the axon, which is the part of the neurons that the neuron that is going to fire and transmit a message to another neuron. And here is, in the lower part of the diagram, we see what we call a dendrite, that is part of the neuron that is going to receive the message. In the cells, in the neurons, serotonin is stored in vesicles. And these vesicles are fused with the membrane and release the content of that is serotonin in this case. And then serotonin travels to the next cell and binds to these receptors called 5-HT2A, as I said before. And because serotonin is very expensive to produce by the neurons, the neurons have a mechanism to recycle it. And they basically have this protein that reuptakes the serotonin that is thrown out in the middle of, in the, of the space between the connection of neurons, and recycle inside. So a normal brain has normal quantities of serotonin, but a depressive brain lacks this serotonin. And so depressive brain don't have as much as serotonin as the normal brains. And right now, current antidepressants work by increasing the amount of serotonin that is in between these connecting neurons by inhibiting the mechanism of reuptake of serotonin back to the firing neuron. That means that the serotonin stays for longer in this space between neurons and is able to activate these receptors. These antidepressants usually take weeks to function, and they are like not perfect for treating depression. Now, why psychedelics can be used as depressive treatment is because both psychedelics or hallucinogenic drugs resemble the structure of serotonin. Therefore, when you administer this to people, what happens is these drugs are binding to these 5-HT2 receptors the same way or in a similar manner as serotonin does. The only thing is serotonin works normally, but these drugs not only induce or could reduce the depression, but also induce hallucinations in the brain. So there is a problem here. We could use these drugs to treat depression, but giving us this other undesirable effect that is creating these hallucinations. So in this paper, they seek to answer this question by creating new drugs that resemble these hallucinogenic drugs, but do not have this undesirable part of the hallucinations. So in order to do that, they took the structure of a protein, and here you can see the structure of the 5-HT2 receptor is these helixes that look a little bit like weird, but this is how actually a protein looks like when we look very, very closely to the almost atom level. So they were able to see how this structure is in this receptor and also see how the structure of these drugs are and how they bind to the receptor. And when they bind, how they change the form of this receptor and activates different pathways. So based on these structures that they were able to see, they model and created new drugs that could have the same effect as LSD and psilocybin on treating depression, but without the hallucinations. So in order to test whether these drugs were inducing hallucinations or were treating depressions, they use two mouse models. In the first mouse models, they use they try to answer the question whether these new drugs are inducing hallucinations or not. So if mice to test whether the mouse are having hallucinations or not, then we look for this head twitch response, which means the mice are like moving their head like side to side very quickly. And this is a normal response in mice. They sometimes do it when they are not hallucinating, but if they do it very frequently, that means that the mice are having hallucinations. And then they also use a mouse model to see if the mice were depressed or not. They use this ARS-induced depression-like model, which consists on putting the mouse in a small cage and keeping it there for 5 hours. And then after these 5 hours, they administer the drug to see if this drug reduced the depression or not. And then they hang the mouse by the tail. When you hang a mouse by the tail, the mouse think they are in danger and they're gonna move and try to release themselves and escape. If a mouse is depressed because they lack this desire or this drive to actually survive or keep fighting, they are not gonna move. They are gonna hang laying down there for a longer time. So when they, in the first experiment, when they use this head twitch response of the mice to test if the mice have hallucinations or not, they counted the had twitched for 30 minutes, as seen here in this bar graph in the y-axis. Here is the number of moving the head for 30 minutes. And here on the x-axis are the groups that they use in the mice. So they treat the mice with the three new drugs that they developed, and they use a control called saline. Saline is basically water with salt. This water with salt, if you inject it in the mouse, should have no effect whatsoever in inducing hallucinations in the mouse. So it can use as a baseline of how many times the mice is twitching the head. So as you can see here, it's around like 15 times on average that the mouse twitched the head for 30 minutes. Then they administered the drugs to see if they were inducing hallucinations. And in the case of 70, 79, and 70, 86, you can see that they administered two different doses of the drug. Why do we administer two doses of drug in mice? And it's to test the effect on the dosing. But why this is important is because if you imagine, for example, when you go and take a Tylenol because you have muscle aches, this Tylenol reduce the pain that you have. But if you go and take, instead of one Tylenol, you take the whole bottle of Tylenol, like let's say 100 pieces of Tylenol, you may end up having liver failure because it just have this undesired effect. So in this case, they use a low dose, 2 milligrams per kilogram, and a higher dose, 10 milligrams per kilogram. And in the case of drugs 70, 79, and 70, 86, the number of head twitch per 30 minutes was even reduced compared to the saline, to the control. But on the case of drugs 71, 13, they observed that this head twitch response was higher than the control and it was incremented by when we had higher dosage of the drug, meaning that this drug was hallucinogenic and they did not accomplish the goal, which was to develop a non-hallucinogenic drug. So after this, they found that two out of the three compounds that they created were non-hallucinogenic, but the third one was hallucinogenic. So from the next study, they only used drug 7079 and drug 7086 to test if these drugs were also reducing the depression as well as they were not hallucinogenic. So as I said before, they used this method in which they restrain the mouse for 5 hours and then they hang it. And in this case, they have here on the y-axis, the immobilization time. And here on the x-axis, the different groups. The control groups that has saline and the treated groups with the drugs. In this case, they also have two controls because you need to have a control of a mouse that is not depressed, how much time the mouse that is not depressed is going to be immobilized in the tail. So in this case, they use saline because it should not affect depression, just water with salt. And they did not restrain the mouse for 5 hours. And as you can see here, around 60 seconds, the mouse is spent immobilized when they are not depressed. Now, they used the other control, which is the depression control. They restrained the mouse. They did not administer any drug to reduce the depression. And they only administered water with salt. And then they hang it. And as you can see, this immobilization time goes up like three times, up to 150 seconds, because the mouse is depressed as if compared to the control when the mouse is not depressed. Then they test the drug and the two drugs, but I'm gonna focus only on one of them because both drugs had the same effect. And in the case of drug 7079, they found that two doses that they administered, both of the doses reduced the immobilization time, meaning that the mouse reduced the depression. In the lower dose, this time is reduced, but it's not still yet as normal as if the mouse wasn't depressed. But on the higher dose, they achieved that the immobilization time was reduced as much as in the control. So meaning that these mice were, quote unquote, cured from depression. So the conclusions of the paper are that we can develop new drugs in an intentional manner using these protein structures that we are able to get in the lab, that the newly synthesized drugs that the authors made in the paper were non-hallucinogenic in mice, and that also these non-hallucinogenic new drugs were effective in reducing the symptoms of depression in mice. What I see that has the main limitations in the paper is that these mice are carried, these studies are carried in mice. And even though this is affected in mice, we still don't know if these effects will carry into humans. We are similar to mice to a certain extent, but sometimes the effects that are very drastic in mice can be mild in humans. And then also this study does not clarify if these compounds are more effective in reducing depression symptoms than the current standard treatments. They should have included another control in which they treat the mice with SSRIs, the current standard for depression, and see if they had even a lower effect or a similar effect of what we have already currently on the clinics. So in general, both Angela and I have shown that how we study ourselves and the society itself impact the science that we do. She explained how studying race or ethnicity, better than race, it can affect future studies. Like she said, how seeing that other people studied this ethnicity changed the way she's going to study her work, and it obviously have an effect on the interpretation of the data and the results that we can have out of that. And I also showed that how our models and society models can affect the study of science. In the case of psychedelics, the fact that these drugs fell under this Controlled Substances Act delayed the research for 40 years, because for 40 years, we were not able to study how these drugs affect the brain and if they can be used for treatment of some diseases. So we wanna leave this presentation with a question: that why, like now what? What do you think as future scientists scientist aficionados thing we should do in the future to improve the science that we do and how we should study us better? And I'll stop sharing, or should I leave it there here and then we start the discussion?
Yeah, I think you can stop sharing. That's okay.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Just playing around with the view. So Luth, Angela, thank you so much for those wonderful presentations of the paper. We have lots of questions that are queued up, some really amazing questions that you all are putting into the Q&A chat. And I am going to pass it over to our Data for the People producer, Em Costa, so that she can help facilitate answering some of your questions.
Thanks, Devin. Hi, I'm Em. I am a lung cancer researcher over at Sloan Kettering. So I work in the same kind of sort of research community as Luth and Angela. Let's just jump right into our questions because there are so many and I'm really excited to hear the answers too. So let's start with one from Marcos. So I guess this one is directed to Luth. Could people develop resistance against psychedelic drugs, kind of as you described they do with antidepressants?
I mean, it is very early stages of the research for these drugs, but the resistant to what we know. To the not the new one, the new drugs, but for LSD or psilocybin, it it does, you know, the it does create resistance. So if you take, for example, a dose of LSD, the next day to achieve the same amount of, you know, hallucinations, you will require a higher dose. But these resistance wears away very fast. Like if you don't take these drugs for a couple of days, you will go back to the steady state. Also, I should say that how they administer these drugs into, like for example, psilocybin and LSD in these clinical trials, they don't administer for a longer periods of time. They are just single doses and separated on periods of time and not a very high dose either. It depends on the study, but so far as I know, they were doing like a few single doses for, you know, like one dose a week or things like this, and also coupled with psychotherapy. Got so, it. Yeah.
Cool, thank you. There's another one from Ava. That I thought was pretty interesting. I'm going to paraphrase a little bit the kind of prelude to it. So this was about coming from Angela's portion of the seminar. So Angela, you know, you featured this study that kind of surveyed, you know, men of either African or European descent, but sampled from men in the US. Like the study was carried out in the US with folks from the US. So Ava's question is, you know, would the immune system of someone born in Africa, and so in that way of African descent, could that be different from someone who, you know, has African descent but was born in the US? Like, is that another variable in that study?
Yeah, that's a great question, Ava. I think that we wouldn't know unless we tested it, but if I were to guess, I would say that most likely the people, men who are from Africa, would have different responses, probably because they would have be of higher proportion of African ancestry rather than be of being maybe of mixed ancestry of European and African ancestry. But also another thing that we didn't really talk about in this paper is epigenetics. So epigenetics is when our environment influences who we are and how we express our genes as well. And so there might be different stresses, different diets, different air quality, all these sorts of different factors in our environment that would potentially impact our immune system as well. So I would, if I were to guess, I would say yes.
Nice, thanks. Also, I study epigenetics, so I'm just very excited that I got a shout out. So here's another interesting one from Hugo that I guess I would say applies to both stories and to human research overall, but I think it's especially interesting in terms of Luth's story. So how does a study move from animal testing to human testing? And I was actually kind of wondering this too, Luth, in terms of like, you know, we demonstrate that these modified illicit drugs or controlled drugs could be helpful in animals. How soon might we see those in the clinic now that we know that?
I mean, usually, yeah, you need these preclinical data that it is called like, and then if the preclinical data looks good, like in this case, that is looking very good, it can jump up into a clinical trial. For that, usually physicians and scientists kind of work together and they propose it as a clinical trial. And once it's approved, I forgot the name of the institution that, because I'm not a translational researcher, but like, I know there's an institution that approves the clinical trials. And if somebody of you knows the name of that institution, you're welcome to like give it the name. But yeah, once it's approved, then it starts what we call the phase one of the clinical trial, that basically this drug is given to people that is like very, that has like no other treatment options, or they are usually, you know, very bad shape or terminal in the in terms of, for example, in cancer that I'm more knowledgeable with, like a terminal people that do not have other treatment options. They are given this to see if they are, you know, if it is safe to give to humans and it can like cure partially the disease. Then if it's safe to give to humans, then they use the second phase of the trial. Then they start giving it to a larger group of people that does not have this terminal thing. It's just like all across. And then once they prove that this reduced, for example, depression in this case, in a larger group of people, then it will jump to phase three, which is basically once it's almost available for everyone, and they just collect data after, you know, all the people can have it, and they test for other side effects that could not be seen in smaller groups of people. And that's how it usually works, more or less.
Got it. Sounds right. Sorry, I'm scrolling through. There are so many questions. Like, great job, everyone. okay. I'm excited for this one and all of them too. Sorry if I just saw this one, got really excited. So this is a question from Yujia, and apologies, I'm not sure if I got that pronunciation quite right. But this one's for Angela. Can different immune responses from people of different ancestries affect how a virus mutates in a geographical region?
That's a really good question. Think about this a bit. probably yes. Different immune responses of different ancestry probably can affect how the virus mutates. Again, that's something that we would have to test. Likely you could probably test that pretty easily if you just isolate the cells of different people of different ancestry. And because viruses mutate very quickly, it's definitely probably easier than answering the reverse question. I would think it can, because if you have a very strong immune response, for example, we could take interferons. So if you have a very strong interferon response, viruses that are susceptible to that interferon response are likely to not survive. So only the viruses that just so happen to have a mutation that is not susceptible, that evades the interferon response in some way, are the ones that are going to be able to mutate. So definitely the immune responses from different genetic ancestries probably affect how the virus mutates.
Right. And as you say, I imagine with a study very similar to the one that you just described, like, you could start to answer those sorts of questions. That's pretty cool. Here's another one. This one's from Rula. And I think this actually applies very broadly to, again, kind of the overall topic of the series in both talks that were given today. In your expert research opinions, can shared or open data initiatives help to reduce potentially dangerous influences on data or interpretation? And can they accelerate the science, do you think?
There is a lot of unconscious bias that we have right now that we don't even know. And then in the future, we'll look back and be like, what were we doing? I don't think people or scientists back then, you know, thought that this was a bias. Like, in fact, of course, reducing this to zero would advance science, because we're applying morals into something that hasn't, you know, is completely out of morals. Morals is coming out from us and from how we interact as a society and what we think is right or wrong. I'm gonna put the example of psychedelics, because they thought it was wrong to take these drugs, that they could not have any effect in humans, even though there was preliminary data in treatment for depression and alcoholism that was promising. Just because they applied these morals, they decided we cannot use it anymore. So it is really hard. Because as scientists, we're also humans and we also have morals. And even though we try to reduce this to zero, we're humans, we're not perfect. And I do agree with you that we need to get rid of these biases. But I mean, I don't think this is ever gonna be perfect, because as humans that we are made by our society and by our own internal biases. And as an example, Santiago Ramón y Cajal, which was a Nobel Prize from Spain that was awarded the Nobel Prize because he discovered that neurons are individual cells. And basically that was like a huge discovery back in the 1900s, 1901, I think it was, or 02. He was saying in his memories that a good scientist should have a good wife to support him. And he also said that women had, they were less intelligent than men. Things that right now nobody would say, nobody, but he was a respectable scientist that was awarded a Nobel Prize. And the science back then would say women were less intelligent than men. And right now we know this is not true. So I think right now myself, I have biases that I probably don't know I have, and I will try to work on the best I can to like reduce this. I think raising awareness and also, you know, being exposed to other people from other backgrounds and cultures helps a lot to reduce these biases. But apart from that, I do not have an idea of how can we like completely eliminate this, because I think, yeah, I talk a lot, sorry.
If I can just add to answering that question about can shared and open data initiatives reduce potential influences on the dangers on data and dangerous influences data interpretation, I would say that definitely it's important for people to have the original source, to be able to look at the original source. And that's what we talked about, primary literature versus secondary or tertiary literature, because some things might get, like if you play the game telephone, things, the information might change as you move on from the original source. So it is important, and it can help to reduce these dangerous influences of data interpretation. But at the same time, it can also be dangerous in the sense that if you're not really an expert in the field, if you don't really study that topic, you might come to conclusions that are possibly wrong because you don't know everything in the context that research was being done and made it in. So it's a kind of a double-edged sword.
Totally. And I feel like we see that playing out a lot in the news and in the media these days sometimes as well, where it's kind of tough to sort of tell of all the different voices being elevated and offering opinions on a subject, you know, like, well, where's this person coming from with what they're saying versus that person? And can be tough to kind of muddle through sometimes, for sure. All right, I think we've got time for just one more question. And this one is for, I just had it. Okay, I got it back. So this one's from Jesse. And kind of, yeah, introduces a really interesting question, Angela, about your study. So the question is, you know, you mentioned that your study only surveyed men, and that, you know, that was a limitation, but also that serving women could make the results less clear, or more difficult to kind of deconvolute. Can you expand on this? Like what might make things more difficult if you introduce sort of more, populations into a study like this?
Definitely. So potentially, so as I described on like the last kind of slide, women are, for example, less susceptible to severe COVID than men are. And part of that might be that men are more likely to have autoantibodies against interferons. So the response, the interferon response and other immune responses in women may be different than men. So perhaps this strong difference in the interferon response between men of African versus European ancestry is you can see it, it's statistically significant, as I said. And perhaps that's not really the case for women, or maybe the difference isn't as strong. So if they grouped the men and women together, maybe they wouldn't see this difference, and you'd have this confounding factor, and you might, that's not really a confounding factor, but it might muddle the interpretation. What I was suggesting is that in order to not have this muddling information, you just separate the two groups That way you can still see this strong difference in the men, and maybe the result would be in women, genetic ancestry in terms of immune response to influenza doesn't matter as much. They're more similar.
Got it.